Okay, so we'll continue with our discussion on the Newton-Raphson method. For the first part of the lecture, we'll look at some convergence characteristics of the Newton-Raphson method, and then we'll apply the Newton-Raphson method to a one-variable problem in heat transfer, and then we'll go on to the two-variable problem, namely the truck problem. With that, our discussion on this successive substitution Newton-Raphson method will end. The next class, I'll teach you Gauss-Seidel method, a system of simultaneous linear equations, and very much useful in chemical industry, petrochemical industry, and so on. And then that will round off a discussion on simulation. And then, as you can see, whether we use the fan and duct problem, whether we are solving the fan and duct problem or the truck problem, you are getting some characteristics. So these characteristics are invariably obtained basically when you do some measurements, which the manufacturer does. So he has got discharge versus pressure and all that. So this will be available in the form of discrete point, so you have to generate curves from that. So in the next 2-3 weeks, we look at regression, curve fitting, exact fits, approximate fits, and so on, so that you are able to generate these curves and use it for a simulation. And simulation has to be logically followed by optimization. So modeling, simulation, optimization, in between somewhere regression is also there. So that completes the whole thing. Then this can be applied to any field you want: electrical engineering, chemical, mechanical. This thing, of course. All our problems, our focus is on thermal systems and energy systems. All right, so this gives you, this will give you a broad base with which at least you can start off. I mean, this gives you a starting point. You can pick up other additional techniques and advanced techniques for multivariable nonlinear problems and proceed. That is the intent of this course. Now, what about the convergence characteristics of the Newton-Raphson method? So what do you mean by the term convergence characteristics? Any answers? What do you understand by the term convergence characteristics of a numerical scheme? No, that is okay, that is very qualitatively, say how does it converge. Quantitatively, what are the measures? What is the relationship between the error in one iterate and the successive or the next iterate? How does it go? How does the error in one iteration or the error of a particular iterate, what is its relation to the error in the previous iteration? Okay. So if it is linear or quadratic or cubic and so on, then whether the error, so the number of decimal places, right? If it is accurate to one decimal place, if it is quadratic, the next iterate will be accurate to two decimal places, four decimal places, and so on. So whether Newton-Raphson method has a linear convergence or quadratic convergence, we will have to examine. How do we examine that?
You take an example,
that is a desi way of doing it, that is a way of doing, but a mathematics professor would not be impressed. What he says is you take an example, solve the problem Newton-Raphson method. Do not take that example x to the power of 8 minus 1 or something. I mean, take a decent example of f of x equal to x minus 2 sin x or whatever, it then look at, you can see that the number of decimal places, look at the previous example, it jumps, no, the number of decimal places accuracy. So you know that it has a terrific convergence rate. You can plot it and find out whether it is linear or quadratic. If you fit a function linear or quadratic, approximately you will have an idea. So that is how an engineer will solve the problem, that is all right. But from a mathematical standpoint, how do you analyze this? So you have to start writing the Taylor series expansion. You have to write the Taylor series, but now you have xi, you have xi plus 1, there is a hypothetical x true or x real, the ultimate true root. Then you expand the solution at I plus 1, you expand the solution around x of true value, and Taylor series expansion, you subtract one from the another and you just try to see whether you are able to get it. That is the whole story. Can you start? I will have a delayed start. You just start. I will start after a few minutes. You understand what I am saying? All right. So one you already know, one equation you already know, that is this is one equation. The left hand side, what is the, what about the left hand side? It is force to 0, okay. I put approximately equal, okay. Now if I say that now instead of xi plus 1 I use x true, okay. Instead of there are several ways of doing it. I can have the quad, I can for example, I can have one more term, the quadratic term. I can have one more term, quadratic term, and this approximately equal can be made to, can be replaced by exactly equal. Are you getting that point? For example, f of now, this way it may lead to some trouble. I have expanded all right, but I made a small mistake on the board. So, what is that? From I, I am going to I plus 1. Next, the logical step should be. I plus 2. That I plus 2 I am considering as true value, for example, okay. Therefore, what I should do is left hand side is all right. So, right hand side, I think what is the correction you want to make? Where do you want to put I plus 1? Okay, the point is very simple. This is all right, right? This step is all right. This step we are doing some expansion. So, if I use I plus 1, I plus 2, I will not get anywhere. So, instead of I plus 2, somewhere I am saying declaring that it is true value, okay. Therefore, I will get an error between two successive iterates, okay. But here I am not getting that because xt minus xi is, I do not know what it, whether it is a successive iterate or not. What should I do?
Minus 1.
Then you will get f dash of xi plus 1, no?
Xt minus
1. Or we leave it like this. We leave it like this and let us see what happens. Okay, so now maybe when we can subtract 2 from 1 or 1 from 2 and see what happens. This expansion is correct. Taylor series expansion is correct. All are close to each other, do not worry about that, Vinay. So, is there an error in this or it is okay? It is fine. Now, this is the true value, therefore, f of xt must be equal to 0. Now, there is no confusion. Now, all of you please do 2 minus 1, left side is 0. What? Yeah, I am forcing. No, xi plus 1 is always 0. No, no. In the Newton-Raphson method, f of x plus i, I am forcing it to, I am forcing it to 0 numerically. So that's why I put this. It is approximately equal. This is exactly equal, but I want to retain the second order term in order to ensure that you don't object. Okay, so now if I do this, what happens? Okay, this is a slightly shady proof, but it's okay. f of xi gets cancelled, so 0 is equal to f dash of into xt minus plus y minus plus this fellow is there. Okay. So what's a big deal?
Xt minus xi plus 1 can be replaced by the errors.
Good. So we are progressing. Though it is somewhat this thing. I did some cheating here by putting only the second order terms. So it's all right. Okay. Now what he is saying is this is actually the error term, true value and this thing. So I can call it as error in the true value at the I plus 1th iteration, correct? There is no problem about this nomenclature. Error in the true value at the I plus 1th iteration, true value minus xi plus, no problem. We can call that as 4. By the same token, xt minus xi will be error in the true value at the good, error in the true value is ith iteration. And then you can take one of these terms to the left hand side, okay. So that f dash of xi into e t I plus 1 equals minus, where is whole square? Not yet. Right side is e okay. Please correct me if I made any mistake. Vikram, any problem? You are frowning.
Just thinking.
I have already ensured that it is quadratically convergent, man. Okay. Fine. Okay. That should be edited. Anyway, we are seeking a solution. We are expanding f of x and all that. Very close to the solution. It's not already we have reached. We are looking at the convergence when it's close and all that. Therefore, I will make some additional cheating now. I will say that therefore, I'll say f dash of xi can be put as f all within limits. Okay, and everything at the true value. Okay, now so around the true value, these two are stationary. How they are stationary? Because I made them stationary. Okay. Now I'm just going to tell you that eti plus 1 is proportional to eti whole square. That's it. So the error in the I plus 1th step is proportional to the square of the error in the ith step, because the other two are constant. because we are looking at the values around the true value. You may say, sir, these are not true values, one is at xi and one is at xi, but I am saying xi, xt, xi plus 1, they are all very close, therefore that is not a serious matter. I want to know how et of I or et of I plus 1 behaves with respect to et of I. That means if this is, suppose you get an error of 0.1, next it will be 0.01, then it will be 0.01 square, so 0.01 to the power of 4. Therefore, the Newton-Raphson method exhibits quadratic convergence, right. So, this is known as quadratic convergence. People who are interested can apply a similar, can do a similar, perform a similar exercise, can perform a similar exercise for the method of successive substitution, and I guarantee that you will have only a linear convergence. We have already seen it live. We did one problem in the third iteration, it hit the optimum, we got the root, right. So, if you apply the same technique to the method of successive substitution, it will result in a linear convergence. So, this is known as quadratic convergence. Akshay Gulati, you resurfaced. What happened? 2 o'clock? Putting sleep or 1 o'clock? Huh? But you were sleeping. Okay. So, this is called the quadratic convergence behavior. As Vikram said, the other possibility is take a numerical example and see how it will work out. You can see that it is quadratically convergent. Alright? Fine. Now, we will go to a problem which we have already worked out using the method of successive substitution. So, problem number 11 or what? Problem number 11. So, today is the 11th or 12th lecture. So, we are in 11, problem number 11. At the end of the course, we will have done at least 40 problems. Okay. So, class notes is very important for this course, right. So, problem number 11, consider a simple way of writing it would be, revisit problem number 5 or 6 or whatever. What was it? Revisit problem number 6, but if you had been absent for that class, you have to write it down. Again, revisit problem number 6. Okay, so I will say it all over again. Consider an electrically heated wire of emissivity 0.6 operating under steady state conditions. The energy input to the wire is 1000 watts per meter square of surface area, and the heat transfer coefficient H is 10 watts per meter square per Kelvin. The ambient temperature is 300 Kelvin. Okay, so we are looking at steady state. There is an input energy to the wire and it is dissipating heat by both natural convection and surface radiation. The ambient for the radiation is same as the ambient for convection. In fact, we had a small discussion about this in one of the earlier classes. It is not always the case that the ambient for the convection should be equal to the ambient for the radiation. Generally, it is the case. So, what is the governing equation for the steady state temperature of the wire? You just copy paste the governing equation from problem number 6. Using the Newton-Raphson method rather than the method of successive substitution, solve the governing equation and determine the steady state temperature of the wire. Decide on an appropriate stopping criterion. The appropriate stopping criterion would be Ti plus 1 minus Ti whole square, right. So, I have worked it out. It takes about 4 iterations. So, maybe 10 to 15 minutes. Is it TS or TW? Thousand, this one is 1000. Point 6 into 5.67 is how much? 3.4. That's okay. Then 3.4. 10 to the -8, right? Okay. Now, we need to get the f dash, right? Four is how much? 13.6. Correct? Huh? It's always negative, is it? Huh? Only negative? This is not good, I don't like it, man. This will work, right? Then okay. But how have you worked? How have you rewritten f of?
Minus
minus.
Oh, so what you have done is? Okay, all right. So this minus sign can be very dicey. It may lead to your downfall, right? We should try to avoid this minus sign. Okay. I just put it as TI instead of TWI. Huh? What's a good guess?
400.
Okay, so we start with
400.
What is the answer?
What is the answer?
400. Now, we have to write the algorithm, right? Here, you can get rid of the W. This is not good, man. This is not good enough. Yeah, so f of ti, yeah, give me some values, it's 400.
Ti plus 1 is equal to 363.7. Ti plus 1 is equal to 363.7.
No, before, give me the step.
You can put it in the formula.
Huh?
595.35.
Okay, then?
18.709.
18.
Now 363.17.
368.17.
So that is about 32. 32 square is how much?
1,012.
Okay. No, no, no. So I want the steps. Huh? It's also being shown to others. No, I want to know whether you have. Is there a quick way of doing it in the calculator? What do you do? Recursive relationship? Yes, sir. Oh, you put it as a function.
Yes, sir.
No, no, see, but you won't have an intuitive feel. How f ultimately should become? F of ti must become 0. So that you can see when you do this. See, very sincere. 31 point. Okay. Then. Yeah. 366.8. 1.4. This is about 2. This is 366. 7. Okay.
16.57.
Okay.
66.3.
Orders of magnitude.
No wonder. What
are you getting answers? So 0.4 into 0.4, how much is it?
0.16.
We'll go. One more. Can you see the quadratic convergence?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll stop with this. Anand, tell me the value. Sir. You're getting something different?
Sir, I started with 350 actually, so I got a difference.
But it is a self-correcting algorithm. If you go wrong in one step, it will correct, but you will take 3 iterations more than your friends. But it's all right. But ultimately, eventually it will converge, right? It will not go astray. Yeah, we'll fill this column out and then Surekha, you got it? Second step you got? 2 steps. Okay. Anybody else? The f should
minus 0.07.
See, that means already there. Minus
0.09.
Derivative will stay close to 10, 15, 20. Derivative is stable, right? That's very important. If that fellow starts misbehaving, if he becomes very close to 0, then we are in trouble. See, this is very 0.09 by 16. So I will put 366.3. Okay. So this is your answer. So solution. So when we started with 400, 4th iteration we got, successive substitution, how long did it take? It took 16 iterations. So if this is quadratic convergence, that has to be linear convergence. So I can argue like that also. But it is very, very powerful. If the problem is well posed, then there is no, you won't experience any trouble, right? So these are powerful root extraction techniques. Even a 2 variable problem you can put down into 1 variable problem and solve it, but I do not expect you to do that, right? But for some cases if you want to get quick solution, if you treat a problem as a one variable problem using the Newton-Raphson method, it is very powerful to get. The other will be there are other techniques like the bisection algorithm, okay, the bisection algorithm where you find out the 2 places where it crosses the 0 mark and then you start bisecting and then you keep on bisecting and then do it. So that is one thing. Then there is a regular falsi method, then there is a secant method. There are so many methods which are available. The Newton-Raphson method is one of the more potent ones, okay, and its convergence is quadratic. Now, how do we extend the Newton-Raphson method for multiple unknowns? Because it is of practical relevance for a course like this, because invariably in thermal system design you have more than one component. How do we handle Newton-Raphson method in multiple unknowns? So let us consider a 3 variable problem, okay, where the variables are x1, x2, x3. No, for example, it will be pressure, temperature, density, whatever, okay. Why did I write 3 variable pressure? So 3 variable problem, okay. So x1, how many equations you need to close the problem mathematically? 3, okay. Okay, we got 3 equations. So you can start with x1 of I, x2 of I and x3 of I. You want to proceed to x1 of I plus 1, x2 of I plus 1 and x3 of I plus 1, which means you have to write f as a Taylor series, in a Taylor series expansion. How do you do that? Can you write the Taylor series expansion for a function of several variables? Use partial differential equation and stop with linear terms, okay. Using Taylor series expansion, is it okay? I am expanding around I plus 1 from I. I is close, I plus 1 is close enough to I so that I can neglect higher order terms, okay. So if the delta x is small, then I am allowed to delta x1, delta x2, delta x3 are small, I am allowed to do that. So this can be equation 4. Should we also get equations 5 and 6? Sure, we will get equations 5 and 6 for F2 and F3 respectively, right. Now the goal is to make the left hand side equal to 0, because we are seeking a root to the, we are seeking roots to the equations F1, F2, F3. Therefore, we force F1 equal to 0, F2 equal to 0 and F3 equal to 0, right. So if you do that, I will call this expansion as 5, this expansion as 6. LHS of 4, 5, 6 is correct. Okay. Then how do you write this algorithm? So left hand side is something equivalent to what is called a Jacobian matrix. It is a sensitivity matrix. The sensitivity of the partial derivatives of the various functions with respect to the respective variables, we frequently refer it to as sensitivity or the Jacobian. So what you have to do is, unfortunately for us, the Jacobian matrix is not fixed because all the elements of the Jacobian matrix keep changing with iterations. There are certain derivatives which will get fixed. For example, in the engine and in the truck problem, if T is equal to 11 omega, we will put F2 is equal to T minus 11 omega, then dou F by dou T will be 1, that fellow will remain 1 throughout the iteration. Dou F by dou omega will be equal to minus 11, he will remain the same, but you have got 3 omega plus 4 omega square or something, it will be 3 plus 8 omega, then when omega changes that guy will change. So some of the elements will be fixed, some of the elements will change. So you start working out like this. Take an initial value of x1, x2, x3, I. Watch very carefully. Take an initial value of x1, I, x2, I and x3, I. Substitute in the respective equations for f1, f2, f3. It is possible for you to calculate the values of f1, f2, f3 at your initial starting point. So the forcing vector, the column vector on the right hand side is known. Then once you know x1 I, x2 I and x3 I, evaluate all the partial derivatives at the point x1 I, x2 I and x3 I. So the Jacobian or the sensitivity matrix, all the elements are known. You also know this, solve this system of equations using Gauss Seidel or you invert or whatever and get this value. You can write this as delta x1, delta x2, delta x3. So you solve the system of equations for delta x. Delta x is x1 I plus 1. Minus xi, x1i, for delta x1, you can do the same thing for delta x2 and delta x3. Now you will get the new values of x, you will get x1i plus 1, x2i plus 1, x3i plus 1. Substitute on the right hand side, you will get the new values of f1, f2, f3. With the new values, rework the sensitivity matrix. Okay. Now you feel bamboozled because it is very tiring and all that. But it is eminently programmable. You just write it, you can write a MATLAB script and it will do in no time. But the moment it exceeds 10 or 12 variables, handling the matrix, sometimes some issues are associated with that. Matrix inversion will not work properly for more than certain number of variables. Then you have to use Gauss Seidel or Gaussian elimination or things like that. But if you have a practical problem, if you are really talking about system simulation of a power plant and all that, then these are the kind of things which will be involved. Now I have just given a general case where you, for a 3 variable problem, this can be extended to any number of variables. If it is a two variable problem, you will have only two elements, okay. So in the fan and duct problem or in our truck problem, we will have to solve only a 2 by 2, you will have to invert a 2 by 2 matrix each time. But you can see compared to successive substitution, this will be extremely fast. And the Jacobian matrix, the partial derivative matrix also give you, additional information on the sensitivity of a solution to the sensitivity of F1 and F2 to the operating variables, okay. Is it time to close or you want to start working out the problem? Okay, so anyway, so in the next class we'll use this technique to solve the truck problem, and with that we end our discussion on Newton-Raphson method. I will teach you the Gauss-Seidel method subsequently. Any doubts?
I plus 1th iteration is proportional to error I square. We didn't exactly normalize the errors, and this would only be valid. This would only make sense if the error values are normalized so that my
In fact, I told you, why the successive substitution does not work. G dash of alpha must be modulus less than 1 and all.
Yes, sir.
See, we are already we are already very close to the solution. Therefore, we are looking at decimal points and all that. So it won't. When it is wildly swinging, what you are saying is if it is 40, next time it becomes 1600, what is the point? That is what you are saying.
Yes, sir.
No.
We are seeing the convergence even when our error values are much larger. So is the derivation such that there is some normalization?
Is there any normalization in
that? No, there is. There is some f dash of zeta.
No, that is that. There is one factor called f double dash, that is one normalizing factor.
But
that is one.
But
you can suppose that confuses you. You say that already you have come to a level where it is less than 1. If it is less than 1, 0.9 will become 0.8 and then 0.64 it will go quadratic. Okay, is that thing understood? He says if it is 40, it will become 1600, 1600 will become. But there is one minus f double dash xi divided by f dash something, no? That will take, that will cool things down. That will ensure that these fellows don't misbehave. Okay, so that's the normalizing factor. Okay, thank you.